I'm David Baddiel, and I've discovered that a lot more than just goods travelled along the legendary Silk Road. Religion and culture came too. I've left the eastern terminus, the city of Xi'an, and I'm now headed out into the mountains in search of the secret of silk.
For many years, it was a state secret, the recipe for silk, and you could be executed if you gave that secret to a foreigner. Sounds harsh. Now, of course, they just block Twitter and Facebook, but then killed for silk.
Back then, I'd have been risking my life pursuing this mystery.
So I've arrived at a silk farm, and I think I'm going to find out the secret of how silk is made from this man. Hello, I'm David. Okay.
Mr. Zhu has been farming silk for over 30 years, oh, right, with the help of a horde of tiny creatures.
And these are worms, oh yeah, they are. When you first see them, they look like tiny twiglets, maybe sort of peckish, eating leaves. What sort of leaves are these?
This is桑叶.
Can I pick out a mulberry leaf with silkworms on it?
可以呢.
Thank you. Oh my goodness, quite a lot of silkworms. And they're all a bit worried about this thing I'm doing. I'll put that back, I don't want to create trouble in silkworm land.
A bumper silk crop depends on feeding the worms their favourite food. Luckily enough, Mr. Zhu has a whole mountainside full.
We're going up here.
The Romans believed that the Chinese combed silk from forest trees. Little did they realise, it actually involves a very greedy worm eating thousands of mulberry leaves.
This looks like a good one. It's perfect. I feel the silkworms will really like this one. I thought mulberry had a fruit as well, called a mulberry. Where is that? Oh, there it is. It's an important part of this process that the mulberry leaf pickers occasionally get to eat some mulberries. That's definitely true. I've read it in a book, a Chinese book. Mm. Very nice. I don't know what the silkworms are thinking of eating the leaves. The mulberries are fantastic. But I could revolutionise silkworm production if I fed them berries. I tell you, if you fed them the berries, they'd be enormous and fat, and the silk cocoons would already be kind of purple. It would cut out whole processing.
But Mr. Zhu's family doesn't just grow mulberries.
Hello. Do you work in these fields? And what are you smoking there?
I
don't know what it is, but it's making me laugh.
It turns out that another Mr. Zhu grows his own tobacco next door.
He is the brother of this gentleman.
Oh, he's the farmer's brother?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Silkworms, they won't just eat leaves straight off the tree. It has to be prepared so the silkworms will like it more. Dinner, everyone. Oh, they really go for the mulberry. They love it. At what point does the worm start doing something which can be transformed into silk?
Mr. Zhu tells me that that's when they start to spin a cocoon. This is the incredible secret of silk. It's made from a trail of silkworm saliva. The saliva solidifies when it hits the air and becomes a filament that the worm spins around itself to create a cocoon. But it's a thankless task. The worms never go on to hatch into silk moths. In mass production, the cocoons are boiled in water, which kills the worm, and the filament is unraveled, ready for spinning. Over 6,000 silkworms are required to produce just 1 kilogram of raw silk.
It is an incredible thing that those tiny little worms are at the heart of this extraordinary industry. I kind of knew that silk came from a worm, because I knew there was a thing called a silkworm, but I don't think whenever I've worn silk, I've ever thought that it's actually, at the end of the day, a worm's house that you're wearing or sleeping on. I think it's okay. We're about to leave, and I did quite a hard couple of hours' work picking mulberry leaves, and so I think I should be paid. So I was wondering if this gentleman here might pay me in tobacco.
Huh? Yeah.
Yeah, just in a tiny bit of tobacco. Yeah, of your homemade tobacco. Oh, there it is. Oh, yes, perfect. Thank you. Thank you. I've got a tiny, tiny, tiny bit of tobacco. It's raining, so I've got to cover it. OK, thank you very much, sir.
So I've got to say goodbye to Mr. Zhu. And sadly, I don't speak Chinese, but luckily, we both speak the universal language of the selfie. Armed with the once deadly secret of making silk, I'm back on the road. Or rather, up in the clouds. One advantage I have on my predecessors on this journey is the invention of air travel. My next destination is just over 1,500 kilometres away from Xi'an, a major trading post on the ancient Silk Road, the desert town of Dunhuang.
It's clear that we're at the point at which the Silk Road becomes the desert road. One thing that's becoming clearer and clearer to me is that with the movement of goods and the movement of trade, you also had the movement of ideas and culture. And coming to China, there was music, there was dance, there was religion, there was art. But we're going now, I think, to the most important and most significant thing that came to China because of the Silk Road.
I'm biased, but I've always assumed that football was an English invention. But since arriving here, I've heard rumours of an ancient game called shuju or kuju, which literally means kickball. Could China actually be the home of football? Because that could be embarrassing. Clearly, the honour of the beautiful game is at stake, so I'm prepared to put my life on the line.
So I'm going to play football with a group of Chinese 14-year-old boys. This is obviously a mistake. Hello, hello, hello. Nice to meet you, coach. Hello, OK. So, this team is Man United.
Yes. Yeah? Yes.
And this team is Real Madrid?
Yes.
OK, so I'm with Real Madrid.
Yes.